I think it's really bizarre that I'm, you know, we shot Anthony Todd Mantle last week, also by Skype. I'm like, so all the cinematographers who know how to make such beautiful pictures are doing Skype.
That's funny.
It's very strange. So this is your home we're looking at?
This is my home.
Doesn't look like a hotel room.
It's not.
We've done that interview. It's fun. Men in hotel rooms. It's always fascinating.
It's always the same.
Yeah, I guess so. So you guys are back remarried, I guess. I don't know how else to describe it, you and David.
Yeah, definitely.
Is it strange to, you had this kind of break. He did 3 or 4 movies without you. You did other movies, obviously.
Right.
And then you came back into Fincher life.
Yeah, sure did. Full fold. It was actually very natural and easy. And kind of flowed right into it. I mean, I've shot some commercials and videos with him over the years since then. And then Social Network came along, and I'm also doing The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo right now.
So is there something that brought you guys back together? Is there a particular style that you do with him that his other DPs have... I guess Darius is the only one who's done only one movie with him besides you.
Yeah, well, Darius did part of Panic Room, and then Conrad Hall took over the rest. Harris Savitas has done The Game and the Zodiac.
Ah, okay.
But no 3 in a row. Now I'm the first with 3. So, I think he likes to change it up and find a particular person's aesthetics that match what he thinks that movie is. And I think Social Network kind of fit in that world. And I had shot an iPhone spot with him and kind of rekindled and a smaller level. My brother and I have a commercial company, and we co-direct together, and I shoot. Mm-hmm. And I think for a while he was thinking that I was just doing that and not anything else. And the iPhone spot, and he's like, "Really?" And so all that time, and I'm like, "Yeah, all that time." And then Social Network, and then went on to Dragon Tattoo. So,
what is the combination? What is it like working for David as a DP? He's so precise. He's so specific. He's known for that.
Yeah.
So how does that relationship work?
Well, I mean, he is within reason. I mean, it's still something that you talk about, and you still make creative choices all the time. He's just very buttoned up and knows what he wants and how to achieve it. And I think a lot of what's misunderstood about him is his desire to be so efficient and to spend the most time with the actors, mm-hmm. and in controlling all the situation, eliminate anything that can stop him having the most amount of time with his actors, mm-hmm. and or cost the production in one other way or another. So, you know, I think it's just being a smart filmmaker and trying to buy himself as much of an opportunity as he can to succeed. And so a lot of people misunderstand that as too controlling or dominating or forcing or lack of entertaining anybody else's input, and that's not really true at all.
I would think that's actually a good thing for a DP to have somebody who's pretty decisive.
Oh, absolutely. I find it a really nice, you know, working environment. And I suppose at some point, if you stopped trying and you got complacent, it would be easy to do around someone that's so intelligent and knows so much about so many other people's jobs and does them probably, if he was an individual cameraman or art director or whatever, would do it as well as anybody else could do it. But that's not the way it works. And I would say on this Dragon Tattoo, he's been the the most liberal about choices and to some degree on Social Network, yeah. Fight Club was a little more structured and had more previses, and there hasn't been any of that on these last two projects.
So so that's a big change over the years, I guess.
Yeah, I think growing up and knowing and experiencing mistakes or discovering things that didn't work and how to make it better and eliminating anything that was problematic before.
Mm-hmm. So Social Network seems very precise. So
it is pretty precise, but it's not it a lot of stuff happened. I mean, he sets the stage and orchestrates like all the musicians to be there, and then he lets them play. You know, so he eliminates a lot of the nonsense or people that can't perform or people that aren't making contributions. But when it comes time to it, you know, I think that one thing about Social Network that seems so controlled is that he was stuck in this 2.5 hour script to make it 2 hours long. Right. And there was a specific rhythm and that in his head that he had to make those scenes work and make them flow the way that Aaron wrote them mm-hmm. and keep it all within a reasonable time zone. So that in itself dictated a certain pace that he never forgot and pushed hard with the actors. I mean, a lot of the direction was, that was great, now do it faster. That was great, now do it faster, because, you know, all of us, including him, were to serve the words because the words were so fun to listen to.
So how does that affect you as a cinematographer? What, is there something different about how you shoot it?
Not necessarily, no. I think that it was, you still approach it the same way. I think that you want to contribute as much as you can to the images and to the words that are being spoken and tell the story visually, but you don't want to get in the way of the dialogue or the performance since it's such a performance-driven piece. Mm-hmm. In other words, you know, big ego photography is not going to serve that movie at all. Right. What it does serve that movie is trying to create subtle situations and create reality without having a heavy hand and then bringing it up a notch or two so it's aesthetically pleasing to both myself and Fincher, and keeping contrast when you can and putting the kids in, you know, dorm situations but not lighting the whole dorm, so it's pretty much like it was when we were all in school anyways.
Right.
And so I think that with the art direction that, you know, that Don Burt brought to the sets and inherently the dark woods that were there, we played that all into the emotion of the photography.
So do you lay that all out 2 months before, or do you lay it all out as you're shooting each section of the movie?
Both. You know, you see all the set plans, you see how they're going to be built, you see the tones and colors that are going to be used. You find out where windows and talk about where practicals are going to be. But you have an overall dialogue about, are we lighting this? You know, is everything coming through windows? Is this all, we're going to do it like a TV show and take the ceilings off and have top light coming from everywhere? Or are we going to put lots of practicals up and make them eye candy and let people be in pools of light? And it was more along those lines, you know. And we talked about incorporating as much reality as we could, and then when we had to, cheat. And I don't think we, you know, I think most of the ceilings were all hard tops. I hate when you can, on the girl with the dragon tattoo, all the sets can't move anything because I don't even want the opportunity to do it. The light doesn't come from there anyway, so it's always a giveaway that someone's doing something they shouldn't do. So
it seems thematically, though, it's different from like the California section from the New York, from the Boston section. It seems quite different visually.
Yeah, I mean, but then again, they were different. They were different as well. You have all those old historic buildings. You have all the dark stone and all of the Cambridge area is lit by these orange sodium vapor lights. Mm-hmm. And so we incorporated that into all the scenes, and we used them on the stages as lights that were outside of windows and whatnot. And then San Francisco is like more glass, and that's all the depositions and whatnot. And right. And we didn't change our styles as much as the aesthetics of the buildings and the locations changed.
So has it, the first time you shot on with David, you shot on film, I assume?
Fight Club was film, yeah.
So and this, now you're in the digital era. Is that transition been easy for you? Does it, is it make it's a huge been, difference?
I think it's a two-part answer. I mean, on one hand, it doesn't change anything. I mean, you still have to bring all your choices, and you still have to compose shots, and you still have to balance scenes and match shot to shot and all the things that are the most difficult. Mm-hmm. What it does change is you kind of have to re-evaluate your normal senses and theories on film, because it's all changed slightly. It's not really reinvented the wheel, but it's, you know, you can't shoot highlights. They burn out. They go away. You have to be aware of practicals. And you got to be more aware of the low end of the film, of the HD. It sees into the shadows more, so it's more about taking away light. And then you also have to take into consideration something too hot and something too dark. When you go to do your telesettings or when you do your color corrections, mm-hmm. they affect each other. So it's not entities on its own, on their own, like in film. If you have the sun in the sky and, you know, a dark tunnel below, that's fine. If you do it in this, it screws up how they can relate to each other, and it causes you to be someplace in the middle that you hate both of them. So you end up trying to bring the sun down and the tunnel up to get the same thing that you would normally get in film.
Right.
So it was just a kind of calculating your head. And I had shot a lot of music videos and commercials in different types of HD cameras, and I've shot with the Red a few times before. Mm-hmm. I'd never used the new chip, the Mysterium X, which we did. We were the first movie to use that chip, and David hadn't used it either. So, you know, we were pretty liberal about testing on all kinds of different light sources, and how much can you trust the HD monitors, and how much can you still use the meter, and when can you use the meter, and when can you, those little things. But in the end, aesthetically, it all comes to the same kind of your own choices, and I just think it's another great way of telling stories. And the thing I think I'm most proud about is Social Network, is you watch it, and most people can't tell whether it was shot on film or HD, and that's a compliment. And I think that's a lot to do with the choices too, like the minimum amount of depth of field. I mean, we shot everything wide open. The color patterns that Don picked for the sets that were dark and fall off anyways. The lens lengths and the types of lights. And I think all those things helped give it more of a filmic, or actually, see, that seems like you're chasing something. Yeah. It made it invisible. You didn't care, or you didn't know what it was. And that's probably more important and accurate to say.
So all the departments are figuring this out together about how this...
I think we all have a common idea about, you know, bright colors and too much depth of field and all those kind of things give you away right away. So that was never an issue. And I think Fincher aesthetically always, you know, I have less to do with the art department than he does, of course. Right. And so I think a lot of those choices are made ahead of time. And then I can go in, and when we're seeing a set for the first time, if it's too dark or too light, or what do we need to do and how are we going to do this, and see the blocking. And then, you know, and then things change when you find out where the actors actually go, or what feels comfortable, or how they become different people during the course of the movie.
Do you feel like you had a complete handle on the digital going into it? I mean, you've done enough testing that you weren't surprised?
No, I thought that I had to trust him a lot, actually, you know, because he had done both Zodiac and Benjamin Button's on the Viper. And this this obviously was a completely different camera system, but it had some of the same issues that you had to deal with. And so I think between that, it didn't take very long to get up to speed. Plus, the camera systems that we were using had done, they work with Soderbergh, who's, you know, one of David's good friends.
Right.
And they had been in on the Red from the beginning. I think they did Che and then three or four other movies with it. So they really had a good handle on it too, as far as like technical issues that would happen and what to avoid. So we were pretty well set, and it went very smooth. There was almost zero incidents. And now we're shooting, you know, I just got back from Sweden, and we've been shooting outside at night, and it's been in the, you know, minus 20 and snowing almost every day. And we've had very little problems.
So you also shot with Mark Romanek.
What's that?
You also shot something for Mark Romanek. You shot a 1-hour photo for Mark.
I did.
So is it? Does it feel like a cult? After, I mean, it seems like there are four or five of these guys who seem completely attached to, in some level, and part of the same fraternity, I guess. Is that the word? Or does that feel like that to you guys?
Well, I think that we're, within a few years, everybody was around propaganda, and everybody was doing music videos and commercials, and certain people took off ahead, and we all interacted together. You know, obviously those guys are super talented filmmakers. I just would like to think that we all kind of matured around the same times and got to places where we all could actually do the same projects together.
So what was the biggest challenge of Social Network in particular?
It was the biggest challenge. There were some technical challenges, you know, for the title sequence and running down the streets at night and outside of Harvard and all that. And I can tell you one little kind of anecdote story about that. But I think the making the depositions interesting to me was the hardest. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where I had to be the most conservative, or at least in David wanted it to be that way. Mm-hmm. And so I felt that was tough, because there was a lot of dialogue and you come back to it a lot. And we wanted to try to make time passage and goes from morning to the end of the day, and it gets repetitive and you're in the same place in the same room. And especially the first deposition with the Winklevosses and all that, because it's pretty much just an old kind of boardroom.
Yeah.
So that didn't leave a lot of, you know.
So the thing that would seem the most simple is the most complicated.
Yeah. Well, because you can't make it interesting.
Right.
Or you fight trying to make it in, I should say. You know, where some things it's a given, like it's just weird to look at, and whatever you do, it's going to be interesting to look at, you know.
So does that mean you're relying at that point on the editor and David making it work?
Well, no, I mean, it's going to work. I'm just saying it doesn't have, you fight your own responsibility to telling the story. I mean,
right.
You can go in there and it could be that we could make a light failure, and it could be, you know, like CSI and pitch black and the... And they all have, like, headlight flashlights that they're putting at their documents. And,
right.
You know, I mean, CSI, I've never seen detectives work in lower light. They never turn the light on. It's only a flashlight, but they find all the clues. I don't know how they do that. But it looks good.
Yes.
But no, we just felt like where we played with the visuals in other parts, that kind of had to be the foundation. And there was so much cutting on the dialogue back and forth. And, I mean, it's cut beautifully. And, I think those guys made magic. So, but I would tell you this: a little bit of a story. The title sequence when Jesse runs, when he breaks up and he makes his trek home and he's deciding he's going to write something that night. There's an iconic part of Harvard University, Harvard Square, and there's these old arches that are the entryway to the university, and the oldest gates of the school.
Right.
And Harvard isn't really fond of filming anyways, and certainly this was not one of their favorite ideas because it left a black eye in the school when students sue each other.
Mm-hmm.
And they own most of the property in the area. So we ended up on the rooftop of one building that they don't own. And the city of Cambridge changed all the light bulbs on two sides of the streets because we see up and down both sides. And, you know, Fincher wants everything perfect. Even all the streetlights have to be all the same color.
Right.
And then we hung lights in the back of those because those weren't putting out enough to make pools of light on the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Then we put lights on trucks that we could pull in and pull out of parking spots because no one wanted us and anybody at their property. Then we took three red cameras. And ideally, it would have been motion control, but we couldn't get them to the rooftop, the motion control rig. So we took three cameras, and we overshot each one, and we tiled them together, and then did a pan and scan through them to get the shot. But what the funny part of it is, we couldn't. The archways are black, and they wouldn't let us put lights on the campus. So I came up with this idea of this light box battery pack that you could push on and off. And Fincher hired a mime. And the mime would push the cart onto the campus, turn the light on, start miming. Jesse would run by, turn his light off, push it off back into the street. And we figured even if security comes, by the time you get done talking to a mime, we've got the shot and we're moving on. And you know, you think a $40 million movie and we have a battery cart and a mime.
So was the mime any good?
He was great. And no one told him what he was doing. And he was just miming his ass off over there, you know, and unaware of what he was doing.
So were you guys doing Mission Impossible through Boston this whole time?
We were treading lightly.
How much did you shoot there and to get? How much did you have to get?
How much on the campus or how much? There's not very much. There's a few establishing shots on campus. There's a lot of footage around the campus, a lot of the dorm exteriors. And then we shot at Johns Hopkins for a lot of the campus footage. Because he just could not get on to Harvard, and it looked very similar in some parts. Not quite as old, but it worked.
So when do you know that you're getting into something that's particularly interesting? The movie, you know, as soon as Sony started seeing footage coming back, they were getting excited and more excited about the movie. Did you know when you read the script, or is it just a chance to work with David, or what?
Well, I think when David calls you, you're excited first. It really doesn't matter what you're shooting. It could be... You know, dog food commercial, and it'd probably be the best dog food commercial you've ever shot. Then I read the script, which I thought was amazing. I just didn't understand. I didn't understand his choice for it at first, you know, until I got an opportunity to sit and listen to how he planned on doing it. And I got to tell you, after we shot the first day was the eight pages of dialogue between Jesse and Rooney, and the breakup. And watching them do it and the way we covered it, it was like, this is going to be good. This is going to be really good. And the way that we lit the first thing, and I'm like, I cannot, this is just going to get more and more fun. And I knew then that it's going to be something. I didn't know how good it was going to be. I saw that first rough cut that we showed at the studio, or he showed, and it was just so excited afterwards. And, you know, sometimes you see a movie and it's still a work in progress and you're not sure, and they went, oh, they did that, or they did that. This was just like, it's fantastic.
So you actually shot all of it, and you were still a bit surprised by how good it was?
Yeah.
Does that happen often?
No. Ever? No. Fight Club was that way. I was surprised how good that was.
Hey. So do you pay attention to the aftermath as the DP?
Yeah. I do all the color corrections and hang out and watch the cut sometimes. And...
But I mean, after the movie's done, are you like sitting there rooting for the box office? And
of course, who isn't? Sure. Oh. I check on the numbers all the time. I know that we're just about to push over 200 million, both, I mean, total international and domestic. And I still think it hasn't been released in Japan yet.
That's very impressive.
Well, I'm with all of them too, you know, so yeah. We talk about it, but... And so, I think David just won the LA Critics Award.
Yes, he did. And New York.
And the Review Board.
Well, that did National Board of Review, but he tied in... Los Angeles was a tie, I think, with Carlos.
Yeah.
But then New York was by himself.
Oh, fantastic.
So the movie is doing very well with the critics so far.
Yeah, There's
plenty of nominations by BFCA as well, so...
Oh, really?
Including, I think, for you. I'm pretty sure.
I don't know yet.
Nobody calls you up at 4 a.m. and says...
No, they don't.
You've been nominated for something?
No. But I do tell you, when you have someone like a Scott Rudin who gets behind the movie and you get the machine going, you're in a much better position to get appreciated than anything else. And I had never been part of it where they put so much into it. And he's, you know, that's one of the things he does best.
Yeah. It's pretty remarkable. So going off to shoot Girl with the
Dragon Tattoo.
Dragon Tattoo. I mean, there's so many of them that I can't keep up with all the titles. Are you shooting one at a time, or are you shooting them all together?
One at a time.
So is it, I guess it's a very different style than Social Network?
Oh, it's completely...
Nobody's sitting in a room talking?
No. There is a lot of dialogue, surprisingly. You know, there is a lot of... But it's it's almost, you know, it's a murder mystery, and it's almost noir in a kind of a Swedish way, and we're trying to be very Swedish about that. If you can embrace Swedish cinema and some of the techniques they use and the soft light that is inherent in the country, ironically, I did 8 movies with Sven Nyquist as a camera assistant and a camera operator, and so. I am quite familiar with his style, and there's no more iconic of a DP from Sweden than Sven. So, you know, it came pretty easy.
But I think that's fascinating that you guys are actually embracing the country.
Yeah.
As much as that as a key element of the movie.
I think it's an interesting choice, but I think you'd be fighting other things there if you didn't. I mean, literally, it almost, I think maybe with the exception of 2 days, it snowed every day we were there. At one point, you know, a little bit here, a little bit there, but it's always cold. It's always on every location is on the water, and I mean it's beautiful, but it's just not fun to work in. It's cold.
And is it any looser than something like Social Network? Is there more room to play, or?
Yeah, a lot more.
Because of the action, or because of just?
I think David? Because his approach to it, and then, you know, again, he takes each project in a different frame of mind, and he's doing things a little different on this, and he's letting the actors be more alive and less stringent, and it's a different cast. I mean, Daniel Craig is playing Bloomquist, and Rooney Mara is Salander, and people like Christopher Plummer is playing Vanger, and it's like such an interesting group of people, and it's different, and he's spending, you know, Getting the Jesse Eisenbergs and the kids from Social Network to do things is a lot different, and for different reasons than these guys. And so I think he's having a good time directing the talent on this.
Well, Rooney is and the whole that whole storyline gets pretty rough. It's a little more Fight Club than it is Social Network, I guess.
Yeah. Well, I think the two meet, and then Seven too somehow.
Yeah. So do you look at the movies that were made in Sweden, or do you even just disregard that they exist?
I saw the original one before I was offered this.
Right.
So I don't know if, I mean, I don't know if I'd have chose to or not. I didn't read the book, mm-hmm. but I did read the script, and there's still things that I get, you know, you mix. All three are slightly different, so right. you mix things up a little bit. And so I'm glad I didn't read the book, because the Sion, the producer, says she gets confused sometimes and, you know, misplaces thought patterns based on all three of them.
So you still haven't read the book?
What's that?
You still haven't read the book since you took the job?
I read the script and
You're
saw the movie.
With the script?
Yeah. My girlfriend read the book, and she's been on the set a lot, and there's apparently the books have so much detail in them.
Right.
That it's kind of would be impossible. And after having seen the first one, they you know, they had a much smaller budget and they were making it local, and
right.
they left out quite a lot of information. I'm sure they had to. I mean, not by choice, just by economy.
Right. So do you develop a relationship with each of the actors in terms of what you're doing? I mean, do you yep. have a sense of shooting Jesse versus shooting Andrew versus shooting the Winklevosses?
Yeah, I mean, the boys are less. I mean, you learn their personalities and you learn their movements, and you learn what you can get away with, you know, facially.
Uh-huh.
The girls, it's more important, and that becomes more sensitive. But then you get someone like Daniel Craig, who's playing a gruff guy who's not really concerned about his vanity. And he's got such an interesting angular face that you can. We've been playing with lighting in from all different directions and taking huge risk. And Salander Rooney is this young, you know, she's 25. She has like anemic skin. It's like glows at night, and she's all beat down as a punker. And
right.
it's almost like whatever I do, I can't make her look bad.
No matter how hard you try.
No matter how hard I try.
But yeah. everybody on the social network looked good. Army actually did. We did an interview with Army, and he did both Winklevosses.
Oh, he did?
So he could match them together, and he had it perfect, even without, you know, there was obviously no script or anything. But he
right.
managed to do both sides without, and they matched perfectly.
It was really fun to watch them. And I tell you what Fincher did, and not taking anything away from Army, because he did a great job. But Fincher cast the brother as an actor.
Uh-huh.
And he would play out the scene with Army, and give Army some kind of different personality and emotional level than he, rather than just kind of splitting himself into two things. And then he would kind of bring his own magic and repeat it.
Yeah.
And so it was fun, because you would get to see both performances, and then you get to see Army do his version of that performance.
Is there any new magic in terms of doing that character, or is it really the same kind of classic split screen, ultimately, digitized?
Yeah, you know, we did a lot of traditional split screens. We started off with motion control at the beginning, and it was just too bulky and time-consuming, and got rid of it. And then there's a few times, for example, when they're rowing and whatnot, where it was impossible, and it's just face replacement.
Right.
So
when you do face replacement, are you shooting the faces for the replacements?
You know, sometimes I didn't this time, because they did it all different times of the year, and
mm-hmm.
you know, we had wrapped in February, and they're doing stuff in June, and they're doing stuff, and I went and watched them do it. It's not really, there's nothing really in this technique that they used, where they digitize the scene, then the computer tracks the light on the face of the actor that's going to get face replacement.
Right.
Then they use these tiny little fluorescent units all over the place, and they do the different color lights based off of what the computer read off the original footage. Then you place the actor there, he sits, and there's four cameras on him, and he watches the playback of the scene, and a magic ball comes up, like on those commercials dancing, and that's where the eyeline of the actor playing him put his eyes, and that's what he follows, and it's identical.
So
you can see how my lighting wouldn't really do much on it. Because it's all based off of what we already shot.
Right. And is there much second unit on a picture like Social Network compared to something like Girl?
No. And there hasn't been any on. I mean, the second unit is art. When everyone's off on Sundays, we go out and shoot plate shots and trains driving by. And you know, it's been my experience with David that we've always done it as our own unit, going off and shooting. That we've never really had, at least the pictures I've done with him, had a second unit doing things. We had second unit on some of the rowing footage in Boston,
right?
And we ended up shooting most of it over again.
Is that just because David knows exactly what he wants, and you guys, it's better for him to be there and do it?
Yeah. I mean, there's some things you have to let go of, and it had nothing to do with the second unit. They just had a bunch of personalities that didn't get along, and they didn't come back with the right kind of footage, and so ended up doing it there and doing some of it in Henley.
So what's the end game for you? When you're finished on the set and you go through the post-production world and you see the movie, apparently you're still checking grosses, but is the movie over for you, or do you continue to have it with you as a part of your family for the next 20 years?
I think it follows you, actually. You know, you end up, after all the nonsense and after it's not out of the theaters and after awards are over and all that stuff, then it's just, you know, whether you do film schools or you talk or people bring it up, or, you know, I do a lot of commercials when I'm not shooting movies, and inevitably the ad industry is just loves and soaks up the feature world, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it carries on, but no, they're done.
Do you still shoot a lot of ads between day and time?
Yeah.
Is it just, I mean, as we've heard over the years, it's the money is much better from what we gather.
Is that pretty much the deal? Yeah, completely.
Is it a different challenge, or is it?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes it's just patience is the challenge, because some of the things are so frustrating. Okay. Dealing with what, you know, it's a very neurotic industry, and they're very insecure, and their jobs don't last very long. So the things that they get afraid of and focused on kind of, I mean, in simplicity, they all want to be doing Nike commercials, mm-hmm. but most of the time they'll pitch an idea to you that sounds so good, and by the time that you get to it and by the time you're shooting it, they've so watered it down that it's nothing more, and you're going to like, well, I don't understand, this is another tampon commercial, and you wanted it to be Nike, and your own insecurity stopped you from being able to achieve your goal. And so that part's frustrating, but no, it's fun. You know, you get to use all the new toys, and it's always something different and exotic locations, and then when my brother and I do it together, you know, we're directing and shooting, and so there's more participation, and it's fantastic.
Another tampon commercial sounds like the movie business.
It is.
So is that, do you feel the changes in the movie business from your position as much as everybody else seems to? I mean, you're kind of in a position where you're one of the very few directors who's still allowed to shoot dramas at a real budget.
It's hard to tell, because the last two movies I've done have been Fincher movies, and you know, he's such a master of owning his project, and the studios leave him alone, and he's super responsible, and we don't make a lot of mistakes, and we're very efficient, and you know, we we finish on time or close to it, or in on budget, and it's all very thought out and professional, and so some of like the huge pressures and strains and threats from that I've experienced in other movies or watched other people experience don't happen. Studio doesn't call me once. No one tells me about dailies. No one has anything to say. It's like David is, it stopped there. You know, and honestly, the way he is now in his career, they don't challenge it anyways. I mean, right. Scott Rudin may have a thing or two to say, but most people don't say anything.
Scott Rudin has something to say? My God, I find it hard to believe.
Hard to believe.
From the land of Scott Rudin. And does that normally affect you if you're not working with David? Do you hear from the producer and from the studio and everything else?
You can. I mean, I have before, and in questions, or, you know, especially if it's something where there's divisiveness on the set, where
right.
a director and a producer are not getting along, or there's you know, subfusion going on.
Yeah.
You get caught in the middle, and you know, someone doesn't want it to look like this or wants you to do this, and yeah, then it gets really interesting because you're in the middle trapped. But to me, it's like the director hired you. You should be presenting his story, and you signed on to make his vision come true, and hopefully that happens.
But Doris Day and Rock Hudson are supposed to be fun.
They are supposed to be fun. You know, that script, are you talking about Down With Love?
Yeah.
That script read so well and so funny. And again, I think that we were too conservative. I think that we weren't traditional enough for the idealist, and right. we were not modern enough with the humor for a new audience.
I think that's absolutely right on that movie. And it's funny because The Tourist just came out, and I think they suffer from the same problem. They're kind of trying to do something very big and bold and broad and very old Hitchcock kind of thing.
Yeah.
And yet they didn't quite get there.
You know? I just saw it 2 days ago with my daughter, and we were whatever.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't quite funny, and it wasn't James Bond, and it wasn't that romantic, and it wasn't, I don't know. It seemed like it just missed. But to me, I saw the trailer, and I thought, wow, I don't understand this movie yet.
Well, nobody goes to a Fincher movie and says, oh, that was okay.
Not usually.
That's one thing for sure.
You certainly have something to say, whether you liked it or not.
Has there ever been any one of those movies that were, I mean...
Fight Club was like a failure when it came out.
But it was an angry failure. I mean, the people who hated Fight Club really hated Fight Club.
That's true.
And the people, those of us who loved it from the beginning and, you know, and still are buying the 13th version of the DVD.
Exactly. And it's still one of the top DVD sales. So, yeah.
Well, it's one of the great movies of all time. And it was, for me, it was the better movie of the, I felt it was very much in cycle with American Beauty. But for me, it was the better, more intelligent, more aggressive version of it. It wasn't quite as... American Beauty is a good movie, but
yeah.
I just thought Fight Club really went for it and just scared people. People just got freaked out by the second act and couldn't quite get to the third act, I felt.
I think they missed the point.
Yes. Yeah.
And the studio was really bizarre. Like, they were so worried about Columbine and us making it look like a fight movie that we shot all these spots that had nothing to do with fighting.
Right.
They didn't use any of them. And the first trailer I saw that the studio cut, it's all punching. I'm like, what are you doing? This is the very thing that you weren't going to do. And it's not a boxing movie. I don't understand what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And I think that the Fincher, the commercials we did were so irreverent that it would have been more in line with what the movie was about. And they would have, you know, but then again, you know.
Well, it took me a while to get, I used to have a fight with Roger Ebert about it back then. And actually did the show the week after he had reviewed it and tried to get him to review it again with me so we could fight about it, and he wouldn't do it. But eventually I think I got him when I just compared it to The Graduate and saw like Matt was a perfect match for The Graduate because the violence of Mrs. Robinson, the affair with Mrs. Robinson, is much like the violence in this.
Yeah.
The ending is almost exactly the same where they're standing there, sitting there holding hands and the world is falling apart around them. And
that's right, as they drive off in the bus.
And you never know what's going to happen. You don't know what's coming next, but at least they've gotten that far.
Yep, that's funny. That's a great analogy.
Yes, I liked it myself. It took me a while to come up with it, but, you know, it was worth it. Anyway, thank you so very much.
Hey, you have my email address. If there's anything, any follow-up questions, any tech stuff, anything you can do, by all means, you know, don't hesitate and we'll facilitate.
We'll track you down. And you're done with Sweden?
We're done with Sweden until middle of March, and then we go back for 6 weeks and 1 week in London.
Fun.
Yeah.
Is Sweden nicer in March?
They say it's about the same.
Oh, God.
So.
Okay.